imagination is a free resource that all of us have access to. So I really hope that both the generations are able to use imagination a bit more. The younger ones are feeling left out, but also the really older ones, seniors who have retired, they are also left out, right? And I think it's very important for us to include them as we're talking about intergenerational collaboration and how we can tap into their experience and expertise so that it's more of a collective collaborative effort and we come with open minds and open hearts. Hi, I'm Sanjana.
And I'm Dirk.
And we're here for Heart to Heart. Dirk, I have a question for you. So we've heard about carbon pricing a lot during this conference, and I want to learn how carbon pricing is helping communities adapt to climate change.
So I think of it kind of on two levels. On a sort of primary level, carbon pricing is attempting to lower emissions so that climate change isn't as bad, so that communities don't have to do as much adaptation.
Okay.
But since we know it'll take a big policy mix and that there's a lot of what we call inertia in the system, that there will be adaptation needs. So carbon pricing can deliver revenues to government that they can then invest in community development projects that maybe make things more durable against storms or floods or fires. And that's probably the way that we're seeing it happen in most places around the world, is how the revenues are used from climate mitigation programs that deliver that mitigation through a carbon price. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. So it's getting funding, right? Because one of the things that comes up with climate change finance is that where is the funding coming from? And this seems like the source of funding that will be used to implement solutions.
Yeah. And I think it's really, money's a big piece of it, but it's also about really inspiring companies and governments to work together on lowering emissions faster and more effectively, because it's really the lowering of emissions that gives us the long-term durability. So it's a bit of both. Let me ask just a more general question for you. What do you think my generation has to offer to your generation in terms of the topics we're talking about around jobs and about the green transition?
One of the things that comes up a lot as we talk about intergenerational collaboration is the knowledge exchange, but I like to be a bit more granular on that. I think it's very important for us to share best practices, but also talk about things that did not work out. I think the successes are often documented, but the failures or the learnings are not, right? And I think it's very important for us to share those learnings. What are the decisions that you made, in what context, and why it did not work or why it worked? I think that is very important. And as I am working in the finance sector, one of the things that I see is for a lot of older generation, you have the experience of making decisions in difficult situation, under a lot of pressure, under limited information, right? And I think like those are the skills that are critical for young people in any industry. And these are things that are not really documented. So I think it's very important for us to exchange things like that. How do you resolve conflict? Because we have to work with stakeholders from different industries, from different countries, and there are conflicts as well. So how do you navigate through that conflict and reach to a solution? I think it's very critical. And I really hope that the older generation are able to share that knowledge and information with us. We need more co-learning spaces with the younger and older generation. Sometimes we might feel like we need to have answers to everything, but I think it's very important to come to spaces with an open mind and just have that will to learn from others and just imagine together. Imagination is a free resource that all of us have access to, but we don't really use. So I really hope that both the generations are able to use imagination a bit more. And one of the conversations I've had about intergenerational collaboration is for the age spectrum. The younger ones are feeling left out, but also the really older ones, seniors who have retired, they are also left out, right? They have all this experience and expertise, and somehow they're also pushed out of the system. And I think it's very important for us to include them as we're talking about intergenerational collaboration and how we can tap into their experience and expertise so that it's more of a collective collaborative effort and we come with open minds and open hearts.
It's great, some great nuggets of suggestion there. It reminded me at a COP gathering a few years ago, we tried to have a sort of an exchange between existing experts in carbon markets or in climate policy and some of the youth community that were present. And I think we scratched the surface of a good idea, but probably a COP is the worst place to do it because everybody has so many competing demands, things that they want to do, but good things to follow up on, I think.
Yes, and I hope it's a year-round effort and not only on conferences, yeah. Right? This is like a place where we meet.
Right.
But the world is so global with like online spaces, so I think it's very important for us to find opportunities to talk and collaborate and speak from heart to heart.
Heart to heart.